On behalf of Walter Isaacson and the leadership team here at Aspen, it's my great pleasure to have you all here today, and welcome back two very good friends of the Aspen Institute and the Aspen Strategy Group. Of course, the former director of the Aspen Strategy Group, to my left, Kurt Campbell, and to his left, David Sanger, chief Washington correspondent for the New York Times, author of the best-selling The Inheritance and Confront and Conceal, out recently. And I just want to take one moment, that's all I was given, but you know, when I attended Kurt's swearing-in ceremony, Secretary Clinton said, everyone has a Kurt story. And I have several. Yes, I have several, but I'm just going to keep it to one, and this is just to illustrate how true it is. We were in New Delhi 2 weeks ago for the 18th round of the U.S.-India Strategic Dialogue, which Kurt ran when he was here. And everywhere we went, both our Indian counterparts in and out of government and also the American embassy all mentioned Kurt and just said, what a terrific job you are doing, how you're always willing to get on the plane, to show up, to talk, and to get things done. And so I just want to say, you just noted that and say how grateful we were to have you here at the Aspen Strategy Group, how lucky Secretary Clinton is to have you at the State Department, and hopefully whenever you decide to leave there that you'll be back in Aspen again with us soon. So, David, over to you.
Okay, well, thank you very much. You've all got Kurt's bio here, but for this conversation, the relevant thought is that he's been Assistant Secretary of State for East Asia and the Pacific since the beginning of the administration, and I would say probably one of the most activist and notable Assistant Secretaries for East Asia, and it is a long and distinguished list that we've seen in generations. Kurt, of course, was a co-founder of the Center for New American Security, and you've heard about his links with the Aspen Strategy Group, he served, of course, before in the Clinton administration. Kurt, you and I were both trained along the way by Graham Allison up at Harvard, and I was talking with him the other day about this conversation. And he had just finished a book that's just come out recently that's basically based on interviews with Lee Kuan Yew. And he asked the senior minister about the pivot, which I think is now called the rebalancing. Is that right? And as usual, Lee Kuan Yew was his shy, retiring self on the thought. And here's what he said. Americans seem to think that international relations are a lot like a movie. They imagine that when they pivot, they hit a pause button and development stop. When they turn their heads back to the region, they hit the play button and hope they didn't miss anything. But it doesn't work like that. If the U.S. wants to substantially affect the strategic evolution in Asia, it cannot come and go. Well, I suspect that you would argue we never left, but I'm interested in how you think the concept of the rebalancing and the pivot has played within the region, and what's real about it? What are Asians actually going to see about it?
Well, first, David, I love movies, so I'll try to. I said I love movies, so I'll try to make this at least somewhat interesting. I do want to say a moment of thanks to the Aspen Strategy Group, to Jonathan, to my old colleague Willow Darcy, who we worked with for many years, and it's great to be back here. And David, I enjoyed our association those summers out in Aspen. It's a great question. It's a good way to start. Obviously, the minister mentor has provided just exceptionally astute analysis of not only regional developments, but about the American role in the region. One of the first conversations we had at the beginning of the administration was with the minister mentor, and he underscored how critical it would be for the United States in the coming period to step up our game in the Asian Pacific region. And what he was talking about primarily was enhanced diplomacy and engagement, and that he felt that as Asia started to restructure its multilateral engagements, as it worked to develop more interconnectivity with respect to trade, as India played a larger role, that the United States had to be part of that conversation, and that was critical going forward. You know, I think in some respects you've had a number of different perspectives about the United States and Asia. There were some who said at the beginning of the Obama administration that the United States is, quote, quote, back in Asia. And then there was probably the retort of we've never left. And in fact, there are elements of truth in both of those statements, and both of those statements fail to capture an essential feature of what's going to be necessary. I would simply say, I think by any judgments, the lion's share of the history of the 21st century is going to be written in Asia. And the United States has to play a role in that history, and to do so, we must be much more actively engaged, not just for one or two administrations, but for several over a period of years in every element of our strategy and diplomacy, particularly diplomacy, economic and trade engagement, people-to-people, cultural exchange. Although, David, the military dimension, which is actually quite modest in this regard, has gotten the most attention. This, in many respects, I think what has been underreported generally is that this has been a diplomatic initiative, by and large. I would simply say that, and this was led at the White House by the President, by the National Security Advisor, and I think also in close consultation and partnership with the Secretary of State. There's lots of questions about should this be called the rebalance or the pivot or the tilt or the pirozhsky or, you know, something else. I like rebalancing, and what I like about the term rebalancing is that it suggests a process that's going to be in continual evolution, which I believe any aspect of Asian policy necessitates. It requires constant fine-tuning. It requires listening carefully to what the region tells us and adjusting our approach accordingly.
One of the parts that you've had to try to calibrate most carefully has been the effort to convince the Chinese that this is not a containment strategy. And I don't know how much more directly the President could say it. He's given speeches in which he said this isn't containment and containment wouldn't work if we tried it. But every time you go to China and you talk through this process, what you hear back is this is just a softer version of containment in different clothing. So the question is, has this been improperly communicated? Do the Chinese have an agenda in calling it containment? Are there containment elements to it?
First of all, I have never heard a senior Chinese diplomat in a formal setting describe American policy as containment. I know that there are some discussions in private sector and other aspects of think tanks that sometimes speculate along these lines, but generally speaking, I believe that the senior officials in China know very well that the United States is deeply, profoundly committed to a positive partnership between the United States and China. Both sides recognize that this is a difficult endeavor, that we have to make our way through very complex challenges. Each side has to deal with domestic politics. We have to deal with regional concerns, and we have to recognize that it is natural for two strong players to have areas of tension in the relationship. I think, generally speaking, when we communicate that our policy in Asia is predicated on a close relationship between the United States and China, we mean this sincerely, and we direct it not just at Beijing, but to the surrounding region as well. It's important that not only China understand what our intentions are, but Asians as a whole. There is wariness in other parts of the region of any attempt of the United States to sort of play a role in which new Cold War tensions would descend. The United States has no intention of playing that kind of role. In every bilateral interaction that we have in Asia, we make clear that our preference is for that particular country to have a good relationship with China. We don't need to say that because every country in Asia wants a better relationship with China, and the United States is no exception in that rule. So I think the key here is to understand the strategic circumstances, and it might be said that the interesting point here, David, I think in about 2008, 2009, in the immediate aftermath of the economic crisis, I think that there were many who speculated that the United States' best days were behind us, that we were perhaps in a period of decline and coming out of the region. That is profoundly not in our strategic interests, obviously, and I think it is a misreading of some short-term challenges that the United States has faced and will recover from. Generally speaking, those who've bet against the United States in the past on American decline after the Korean War, after the Vietnam War, after the Cold War, have lost an enormous amount of money. And I believe that there are ample reasons to believe that the United States will be a sustaining, powerful, and a reassuring presence in Asia for decades to come. And that's what we want to communicate, not just to China, but also to other friends in the region as well.
Is it a fair reading of events that in 2009, when the president reached out to Hu Jintao to try to build a partnership out of the economic crisis, starting with their first meeting in London, that the Chinese cooperated for a while and then came to view those requests as a sign of weakness? And that the next few years, as you have seen, the territorial claims that have been made and so forth, may be a reflection of that, or are they a reflection of some internal dynamic in China that we had very little to do with?
Well, I'm not sure I would agree with all the dimensions of the question. I will say that when people look for examples of U.S.-China cooperation, particularly in circumstances that are most difficult, it is undeniably the case that in the period 2008-2009, when the United States takes some drastic domestic economic action, so does China, playing a role to sustain the global economy, clearly for their own interests as well, but in a way and in a manner which was of crucial importance at a moment of macroeconomic and policy economic policy challenge. And I think that effect has been powerful and important. I would say that we have had a number of areas where the United States and China has managed to work together quite effectively over the last couple of years. But, David, as I said at the outset, there are inevitably going to be areas in which we have disagreements, areas of miscommunication, in which more dialogue, more sustained engagement is the prescription. Ultimately, I believe that the Chinese leadership, and particularly the incoming Chinese leadership, believes that the United States is going to play a role in Asia for decades to come. There are questions about that. The only way to answer those questions is to demonstrate it through policy, activism, and engagement. So there's not much more I can say or others. We just have to show it by doing it. But I do believe what China has seen from the United States, active role in the emerging architecture, very deep bilateral engagement in all the important institutions like the Strategic and Economic Dialogue and other the other economic endeavors, but also new venues like the Strategic Security Dialogue, in which for the first time we've been able to touch on very challenging issues like cybersecurity, maritime issues, and other issues like defenses, strategic defenses. And I've been privileged to have what for me has been one of the most interesting, I think innovative, and extraordinarily helpful sets of discussions with my counterpart on Asia. The irony is that until very recently, the United States and China did not talk very much about Asia, but the Asia-Pacific consultations have been extraordinarily helpful in making sure that the United States and China see eye to eye on critical developments like Myanmar, North Korea, our engagement in Southeast Asia and the like. So I don't think those reads about somehow the United China sensing weakness are accurate. I think they're simplistic, and I don't think they reveal the depth and complexity of the relationship more generally. And most importantly, I think now that our government has settled in, the Chinese have had a very substantial period to work with us, I think they recognize that not only are we here to stay, but we are determined to work closely with them.
Well, you mentioned our government settling in. We now have one of those odd moments where you have obviously the same president, but a new Secretary of State, new Secretary of Defense, new CIA head coming in. In China, you have a new leadership team around Xi Jinping. You're about to have the inauguration of a new South Korean president. You just had a new prime minister in Japan. So as you look at this constellation, how does the interaction change within that group?
Yeah, it's great. It's a great question, David. And, you know, transitions are moments of great delicacy in any environment, but particularly in Asia. And one of the things that we have sought to do quietly is to ensure that expectations are understood among the key players in the region. I think, as you know, we took a strong interagency team to Japan and Korea in recent weeks to ensure that there was a good understanding about how both sides wanted to see improved relations over the course of the coming months with a new team in both Tokyo and Seoul. We've been in very close consultations with friends in Beijing and in Tokyo about our strong desire to see responsible, engaged leadership on each side to rise above these local tensions and recognize how important a collegial, strong relationship between Japan and China is, not just to Asia, but the world in particular. And we've provided some ideas and insights in that overall game plan. Ultimately, it's going to be important for early engagement among all the key players, and you're beginning to see that. There will be some announcements about upcoming high-level engagement with between our government and the incoming Korean government. Obviously, with Japan, and we are beginning to see what we think are important signs of high-level engagement between Japan and China, particularly over the weekend. And so we encourage those trends. We want very much to see that that all of these relationships, these complex relationships in Northeast Asia, get off on the right foot.
If there's one other initiative that's probably associated with you in your time as Assistant Secretary, Kurt, it's probably the re-engagement with Myanmar, something you worked on very hard. And I know from our previous conversations, in the early days of it, you weren't quite sure which way it was going to go. So you had a president of the United States who, in his first inauguration, talked about engagement and the campaign that led up to it with states that had previously been adversaries, North Korea, Iran, Cuba, Venezuela. Of that group, only Myanmar sort of mailed the letter back.
Yeah.
What was the difference? What was it that you found that that we did differently as the United States government, or that the Burmese did differently that made the difference here?
David, it's a great question, and it's actually one that I spent a lot of time thinking about and reflecting on, trying to understand. You know, it's an incredible journey. It's very exciting to be in the process of engaging a country that has been shut off from the global community for such a long period of time. I will say, in my first meeting with Aung San Suu Kyi, in which the then junta allowed us to have, she was brought from her residence, which is now, you know, so well known, but in an unmarked car to an old Russian hotel building that was on the lake of the river that's in downtown Rangoon. I remember standing outside waiting for her to come, and I looked back and, you know, the windows were open and there were these long curtains flowing in the wind, and it was really one of those kind of, you couldn't help but stop and kind of marvel at the moment. The word had gotten out that the leadership was going to allow her to meet with us. And so as far as you could see, people were coming over the hill. There were hundreds, perhaps thousands of people waiting for her car to come up. And she arrived and the door opened. And I remember looking at her and thinking to myself, that's Aung San Suu Kyi, you know, just, you know. So she came in. And she was incredibly precise. She says, we have 2 hours and 30 minutes exactly. So let's have a schedule of how we want to discuss the issues. And she said, the first issue we want to discuss is, why is the government choosing now? What are the reasons that they have decided to engage? And we spent the first 45 minutes discussing what were the internal and external factors that influenced the government to make this what really could turn out to be an absolutely historic term. Burma, 50 years ago, was one of the most thriving countries in Asia, remarkable agricultural production, fine universities, and now in
they sold the same cars, actually.
Yeah. Now, in many respects, is has fallen tragically behind. There are a lot of reasons, David, that people have speculated on. You know, whether surrounded by powerful neighbors and the like. But I do think there is one factor that cannot be underestimated, which is remarkable. When I was there on that first trip, I met then the man who was serving as the prime minister, the number five in the junta, a very mild-mannered and quiet man, Thein Sein, and we had a series of discussions in which he was very careful and not particularly forthcoming. I wouldn't have anticipated that he would be the person that would emerge as the first leader in this complex new era. And he has taken steps that, frankly, no one would have anticipated then. And by all accounts, he was chosen for a variety of reasons, but one of the reasons was how careful and how cautious. And he was welcomed by a number of groups within the military organization. But I'll tell you the interesting thing. In his role as prime minister, essentially, he was responsible for traveling to meetings, right? So when Myanmar, Burma would participate in ASEAN meetings or the like, they would send someone. Obviously, it had very little to do sometimes. But he would spend a lot of time going around looking at cities, looking at universities. He's very technically oriented. And it became clear to him over that period, about 8 years, 7 years, that his country had fallen just horribly behind, and that the system of government in many respects had failed its citizens and a proud and very independent-minded people were at risk of being at the mercy of forces outside beyond their control. And I think he made the determination that it was important for the country to embrace reform. And then once that process has started, he has joined in the most unlikely of relationships with Aung San Suu Kyi. And she has demonstrated a very real, pragmatic, problem-solving capacity that in many ways is remarkable. I was struck when she received the Congressional Medal of Freedom that there was more interaction. Is that the right medal or Congressional Gold Medal? I'm sorry if I got that wrong. There was more interaction between her and the representatives of the government who were sent there to respect her from the government than there was between Republicans and Democrats, who at that particular time were in the midst of a very tense set of deliberations on the budget. So, these are people who've been imprisoned, who've had remarkable tensions between one another, but they've decided for the sake of a better future to try to work together. Now, the truth is the process, we're at the very early stages. We're at the earliest stages of the opening that will take patience and sustained commitment on the part of all of us. And the most important part is yet to come. Sustained, responsible economic engagement, bringing Myanmar into institutions, working with them. I believe they've taken important steps, but we know all we have to do is look at the violence in the north, other problems that there. This is an incredibly challenging situation, David, that's going to take a lot of work and engagement, not just of the United States, but other countries, Britain, Japan, Australia, New Zealand, all of Europe. But responsible steps have taken, some debt forgiveness, responsible investment, very close coordination behind the scenes between the donor countries, oftentimes led by Britain, other countries involved in the mix, I think is hopeful, but it's going to take years more. And it will have to be sustained through the next presidential election that will take place in 2015. I will say, just in conclusion, the wonderful thing when we visited with President Obama and Secretary Clinton and their teams when we were in Yangon in December, it was interesting to see how quickly politics was afoot for the next presidential campaign, right? So they were already maneuvering and had taken completely sort of the dynamics of a democratic state. A lot of people were saying, look, you know, we've got to give due course and we've got to spend more time with the parliament and, you know, how the parliament was interacting with the executive. In many respects, it was quite hopeful and in many respects, just, you know, energizing. But again, the time is the next several years are going to be critical and we will have bumps in the road.
One last question for you and then we're going to open it up. If Myanmar was probably the greatest success story, I would probably have to say that North Korea has been less than a great success story. In fact, their first nuclear test was, what, 3 months into the president's term? Some people send greeting cards when new presidents arrive. They set off a nuclear test. And I remember some of your colleagues telling me that at that moment, everybody in the Obama White House basically became a North Korea hawk. From the moment that that first test happened. And engagement has not been the hallmark. There have been a couple of attempts back and forth, but the last one was just about a year ago, February of last year, and it fell apart almost instantly. A year ago, I remember visiting you, and you were still trying to figure out whether Kim Jong-un was seriously going to go look for economic reform or whether he was going to try to pacify the military. I think maybe this weekend we got our answer on that when he said that more tests were going to be needed. What's your read? If they do another test, which they've all but said they're going to do, what does that mean? What's it tell you in a bigger sense about Kim Jong-un and the military and his own security within the hierarchy?
Mm-hmm. Well, thanks, David. And as everyone knows, there's hardly any challenge as difficult and as intractable as North Korea has proven, not just for this administration, but for a succession of administrations. I think there are some things that we point to as relatively positive signs, but they are not with regard to North Korea directly. We have very close partnerships with the surrounding countries. I would say the U.S.-ROK relationship has never been stronger. Mm-hmm. We've worked in a way on every aspect of our diplomacy, including responding to the provocations in such a way that has elevated the U.S.-ROK relationship to new heights. I think we've likewise been able to trilateralize certain engagements between the United States, Japan, and South Korea. And even though we do not always agree on North Korea with China, the path and pace and intensity of our diplomacy is very strong. And so I don't think that there has been gaps, particularly, in that can be easily exploited, even in difficult situations of the kind that you've undermined. Secondly, it's clear that North Korea has survived by certain kinds of economic and other activities with countries like Burma, Myanmar, other countries in the Middle East. And I think through very concerted steps that have been orchestrated by the White House and Treasury and elsewhere, we've been able to curtail substantially some of those activities.
Less missile trade.
Yeah. And that has put pressure, undeniably, on Pyongyang. It is also the case that we have been very clear about what are the parameters necessary to return to talks. Glenn Davis is in the region now, Ambassador's had good meetings in all capitals, underscoring our concern and how we strongly discourage any provocative acts, including a potential nuclear test or other activities. I think we, Mr. Lippert from the Defense Department, Mr. Russell from the White House, and myself met with Chairwoman Park of the incoming government in South Korea a week and a half ago in Seoul, And it was very clear that as they go forward, they want to go forward in tandem with the United States in any effort to carefully and responsibly begin a dialogue with the North. I think our message generally to China and elsewhere is please demonstrate very clearly that steps that are contemplated could have a deeply negative consequence in terms of creating an environment where it's difficult to resume the kind of diplomacy
Kurt,
that we all hope for.
They've sent off any number of tests before. What difference would a third one make? In fact, if their supply is limited, one of your colleagues once suggested to me we should turn around and say, gee, I bet you can't do that again, and see how much of the supply they can run through. So at this point, what more damage does it do?
Well, first of all, we don't know the kind of test mm-hmm. that is anticipated, and that's something that, given the potential things that could be involved, that could have a very serious consequences. Mm-hmm. It is also the case that nuclear tests create anxiety in allied states, create anxiety in China, raise tensions generally in a manner that's not in our strategic interests, and further calls into question any intention on the part of the leadership to abide by the commitments they've made to the six-party talks to move forward on denuclearization. So we're at a very delicate period here. We've been in very close consultation with Beijing. As you saw, they worked with us behind the scenes on the Security Council resolution. That was a surprise to many, but it sent a very clear message of determination, and we believe that the Chinese have weighed in no uncertain terms with Pyongyang to attempt to discourage North Korea from conducting any further provocative actions.
Congresswoman Harmon?
Well, thank you.
Hi, Jane. I didn't see you there.
Hi. I traveled halfway across town, Kurt, to tell you what a spectacular job you've been doing. And I was in Seoul, actually, a day after your visit, and it got rave notices from the Park President-elect Park's transition team. And I think she will turn out to be very different from her father and very much a modern leader, the first woman leader of Korea, and it's very good news. But today in Washington, the human rights activist from China, Chen, the blind activist, is here mm-hmm. receiving an award from the Lantos Foundation. And last night, he and his family were at a small dinner with Richard Gere, the actor who's been very active on issues involving human rights in China and Tibet and others. And looking at this lovely domestic scene, I recalled the role you played in finding a formula that was face-saving for us and for China on the brink of Hillary Clinton's visit to China to get him out of China. And so I just wanted to ask you to tell that story, but also to describe the lessons learned in that. I mean, it seems to me still, sadly, with respect to North Korea, China views our role as views its role and ours as a zero-sum game. You know, if we're if our relationship's getting better, then they're against it, and if there's this, you know, etc. And instead, both sides can win if both sides work together. So I guess it's what are the lessons of the Chen experience for other tough problems that we are facing in the region?
Thank you, Jane. I appreciate the question. You know, the truth is, for a variety of reasons, those of us who've been most intimately involved in this have said almost nothing about this for a long period of time. And, you know, there will be the appropriate time to discuss it. But I will say that, you know, everyone's occasionally involved in something that's much bigger than yourself. You feel that sort of the, you know, kind of the larger, you know, weight of history or the winds, you know, kind of blowing. And for me, that was that experience, and it was both deeply worrying, exciting, you know, exhausting, everything. I'd love to be able to say that, you know, that it was, you know, a triumph of American diplomacy. I think the people involved, Secretary Clinton in particular, backed up by the White House, showed a very stable hand and very careful hand, but the truth is, it was Chinese diplomacy that was remarkable during this period, in which we were able to work on a number of things that has received very little attention. It is true that when Chun came into our embassy and we spent a lot of time with him, he was clear he wanted to stay in China. He told us on repeated occasions that to leave China would mean that he would potentially not be relevant to the country's future. He wanted to be in a circumstance where he could influence the situation on the ground there. He thought that this was an exciting period. He looked up a lot to the writings and the teachings of Wen Jiabao, was interested in the role that he might play, wanted an opportunity to engage on some of those matters. He was deeply committed to rural issues of health and family planning and education. And what he really wanted was a chance to study. He was self-taught. He wanted to go to university, preferred to go to university in the United States, in China. So over a very difficult set of a few days with Harold Koh in particular, we negotiated what we thought was a completely unprecedented arrangement with the Chinese government, where Chun would spend a few years at a university studying under certain kinds of support from the West, and after 2 years would have the opportunity to come to the United States. We were very clear with him that, you know, once he left the embassy, that he would be going into a very difficult set of circumstances, that this is not, that he was choosing a life of struggle. And he basically said, that is my life as it is now. It's what I've chosen. This is what I want. This is what I believe in. And we worked with the Chinese government to have his wife released and his children, a few that he had not seen in years, and very intense, very difficult diplomacy, but a very intrepid course by our primary interlocutor, Sui Tian Kai, who will be playing a continuing role in U.S.-China relations. So he helped us negotiate, I think, what is really an unprecedented arrangement. And then for a variety of reasons, when Chun left the embassy for the hospital, I think his exhaustion, he got a lot of advice from colleagues and friends that was different. And, you know, as happens in life, he changed his mind. And he changed his mind quickly and starkly. And put us in an immediate set of circumstances where we had to shift gears under enormous political pressure. And with the strong support of Secretary Clinton, we were able to work in a period, again, of 2 days to come up with another basically unprecedented deal. Now, none of that has gotten very much positive attention. It's more, you know, the question about, you know, abandonment and other issues, without recognizing the enormous stress of his escape, the lack of sleep for weeks, all the things, the enormous duress that he was under. But I would say that as a team, I'm very proud of what we did, and enormously proud that the people that I work with stood by us. I'm just going to just recount one story just as I was thinking about it. But there was one period when I was with Secretary Clinton, and I was having a lot of misgivings about whether we had done the right thing, right? I don't think we had any choice in the matter, but so you always
before,
have questions.
After he was in the,
he was in the embassy.
In the embassy.
And
before
we were,
the hospital.
Yeah, before the hospital. And we were in very difficult negotiations. It was very tough. And frankly, I was exhausted. And she had just arrived from Washington. And she said, you know, Kurt, I make a lot of difficult decisions, and sometimes, you know, I can feel it in my stomach. I've never felt it on this one. This is a very small price to play to be the United States of America. And it was completely buoying to me, you know, at a time of enormous anxiety. You can see I don't talk about this very much, but it was an incredible experience. And I will tell you that for me, at least, I come out of this with much greater confidence and trust of what the United States and China can do if we are facing a problem that we can work on together. And so the key, as you put it, Jane, is how you frame problems. It's not, you know, how do we get an advantage? How do we solve a common problem together?
Okay, so we're going to go to Steve Clemens, and then we have the murderer's row over there, Huff Bauer, Mann, and Lieberthal. Nothing's been seen like it since the 27 Yankees.
It's ugly. With Ken batting cleanup, so lots of men on base.
Thanks so much, Kurt, and I appreciate very much the constructive frame in which you put U.S.-China relations. But the other side of that, Bob Manning has a very interesting and good article out right now saying essentially that the best friend U.S. strategy has in Asia right now is a muscling, bungling China that keeps making misstep after misstep, that things like fights over the Senkakus, cutting cable ship lines, going into Malaysian waters is essentially changing the dynamics such that, that despite the excellence of our diplomatic corps, they're helping us essentially create new infrastructure and relationships in the region because China's blowing it. You know, Frank Fukuyama once wrote a piece, you know, on China's global charm offensive. When the United States seemed to be distracted in the Middle East, it was sort of an open door for the rest of, for China and the rest of the world. Now things seem to have changed. And I'm interested in whether, despite, you know, the good spin you've put on the China side, that they are testing the United States, they're testing these relationships. I don't know why, but Manning argues that we would not have seen the changes in the region had China not mismanaged its own portfolio so well. So I'd be interested in your views on that.
Certainly, Kurt, that is something you sometimes hear on background from some of your colleagues who think the Chinese have just overreached.
Look, it is undeniably the case, Steve, that Asia looks for other countries to be engaged in Asia. So Southeast Asia, South Korea, Australia, New Zealand, other countries look for the active engagement of other powers to play a reassuring role in a rapidly changing set of power dynamics in which China is predominant in every aspect of political, financial, economic, and security relations. India is still a nascent player in Asia. I think everyone has high hopes for the role that they will play going forward. We are very much engaged in a strong dialogue with Europe to see Europe play a more constructive and positive role in Asia. And more importantly, for the United States and Europe to work together to recognize that everything that the United States has ever done of significance, we've done with Europe. The gaping hole in a very robust set of discussions between the United States and Europe is Asia. Now, that's improving, but that's going to take time. There are concerns and questions about other powers, whether they're going to be able to sustain the capability to play a role into the 21st century. And so for a variety of those reasons, Steve, I would argue that there has long been a desire for the United States to be actively involved and engaged in Asia. So I don't believe that that's new. I think we've only recognized it of late, over the last 10 years or so. And the biggest difference between now and the 1990s is that in the 1990s, you'd go to various countries and you'd get hassled on culture or, you know, some other things. Basically, what you hear now when you travel to any Asian capital is, when are you coming again? Thanks for the visit. When are you coming again? So I would say, generally speaking, there is a very broad desire for active American engagement. My own personal view is that that extends to China as well. I would also say to those who believe that higher in, you know, tensions lead to greater possibilities for the United States to engage in Asia, I think are missing a larger dynamic, which is that kind of cooperation can only go so far, frankly, before political anxieties arise and other tensions. It is much more likely that the United States can develop deeper, broader, more sustained relations in Asia broadly when U.S.-China relations are stable and secure. And so I think that Bob's argument, which I've read and seen, misses that essential feature. And being a person who is out there on the tip of the diplomatic whatever, I see this very clearly. These countries throughout Southeast Asia, South Korea, Australia, New Zealand, India want to see the United States and China working problems out. Even if there are tensions, they want to see us sitting down, taking the time and effort to work through that. They expect that there will be difficulties and that we will face some very tough times, but they will not settle for a set of circumstances in which the United States and China don't put everything into trying to work those problems through.
Gary.
Thanks. And I'm afraid my question descends from this 30,000 foot level down to the Washington murk and comes from the high reaches of diplomacy down to economics. So the administration has let it be said, though without an official spokesman, that they want the Trans-Pacific Partnership negotiations to ripen further before seeking congressional approval in the form of Trade Promotion Authority or some new name for fast track. Those of us who spend our time in the vineyards of trade policy are extremely skeptical that this is a formula for bringing TPP home this year or early next year, for the simple reason that foreign countries have very good trade diplomats, and they're not going to give on their difficult issues when the administration does not have authority from Congress to give on difficult issues like dairy and sugar and textiles and government procurement of services. And there's a long list of things which will activate congressional opponents to oppose the TPP if the negotiations go forward without their prior consent. So my question very directly is whether the State Department agrees with this approach of delay, get other countries to put all their valuable chips on the table, take these chips to Congress and say, look at what a great deal, buy it. Do you subscribe to that?
Thank you, Gary. Let me try to make just a couple of general points, then I'll try to answer your question directly. Look, what Asia really wants is an active, engaged, optimistic American economic and commercial presence. And as we shift over time to an Asia that will be focused more on consumption and services away from just production and exports, for the stability of U.S. Asian relations, for true fiscal and monetary rebalancing of the kind that will be necessary, in which we save more and sell more, this is going to be the critical component of our diplomacy going forward. And so the economic piece, the trade piece, is critical. I think a good down payment was made with the Korea Free Trade Agreement. And what I thought was valuable, particularly about that agreement, is that the expectation was that it would fly through in Korea and that we would be stuck in just the most laborious internal debates about ratification, when in fact it flew through with a higher percentage of votes of any trade agreement in 20 years. Now that probably is as much significance of the attitude of Americans towards Korea, but there were some tough issues on the table and there will be issues that will need to be addressed going forward. TPP is vital and central to American economic and commercial strategy going forward. Now, I don't need to tell you, Gary, that we are just coming out of our own election and probably quite close to a new trade and economic team taking shape. And so I don't think we've heard lots of advice, frankly, of what the concerns are. And they are, first of all, the strategy about how to get congressional authority. They are about whether to seek expansion in the number of countries now or whether that risks problems. And they also have to do with the phasing of how you would seek particular parts of the treaty first or wait till later. I would say that everything from the last meeting in Auckland, everything, we're in that kind of the, what Russians call peredushka, kind of a breathing space, that period right before major and fundamental decisions are taken. In the United States, they begin, frankly, with the new trade ambassador and the termination of the president to get this done. My sense is that if we don't take clear, demonstrable steps that we could lose momentum. And I don't think the president or his team has any desire to see that happen. So the next 2 or 3 months, 4 months are going to be absolutely critical. There's only so much the working teams can do without that high-level engagement, and that involves not just the executive branch, but the congressional branch as well. I know I'm not directly answering your question, but I think you see people understand the dynamics here, and trust me, in the last set of negotiations, it was clear that many of the key countries were holding back, and just not just on the areas that you mentioned, but in other areas as well. That's got to be something that has to be addressed in a more holistic way.
We promised Kurt he'd be out of here in about 20 minutes, so I'm going to ask for short questions and short answers.
Okay.
So that
or longer answers.
Or longer, depending on what
your
strategy
questions,
is.
Yeah.
Would be because you know Secretary Clinton's time is running down at the State Department, so you only have 4 days to solve all of these, including North Korea.
Yeah.
I think, Jim.
Kurt, I want to ask you about a very broad question involving China, which is, you know, you've watched the debates in this town for many years, red team, blue team, people sympathetic to China, people not. But this one transcends those. There are some people who think that the Chinese leadership is going to have to democratize or at least dramatically liberalize. People on both sides of the debate, and there are others who say no, you know, it can go on for a good while as it is. One interpretation on the Chun byplay was that you negotiated what would have been a dramatic agreement for him to stay in the country, and that some people were willing to go along with that, and then the security apparatus helped change his mind by reminding him what he was going back into. Is this, Ken, in your dealings with the Chinese, do you get the sense that they really intend to or feel compelled to dramatically change at this point or not?
You know, Jim, I'm not sure I can give you an excellent answer to that question. I can tell you that you know, if you are engaged in very intensive interactions over a sustained period of time, you come in contact with people, and you know, if you're out late and you have discussions, I think I can make a few generalizations. You know how sometimes people say that with an incoming new team in Beijing, that the outsiders always put their best hopes on that that person and the team about the prospects of reform, issues associated with corruption and matters relating to representation and imbalances in wealth and other disparities. I think there is ironically a similar dynamic inside the country as well, and some of the key players have hopes and expectations, and you see that playing out over time. What tends to happen, particularly during a period like this, beginning right before the Party Congress, and now as we head into a period in which some of the key second and third tier officials will be appointed, there is a tendency to take certain signs and read a lot into them. And it's not clear whether it's possible to make those judgments. So I could imagine there are some things that we've seen that would suggest, yes, there are real interest, particularly in some structural economic reforms. But others would point to some other steps that would suggest an interest in at least exploring certain parameters on the domestic scene. My own judgment would be that it is entirely too soon to tell, and that I was struck, I didn't have as much time as others have had, but I've spent, you know, 20 or so hours with Xi Jinping, with Vice President Biden when he went to China and when he came here, and then in other meetings with Mr. Donlan and the like. He is a very careful and precise individual, at least in our discussions. He's more informal and more relaxed in some respects, but if you listen carefully to his message, it's very it's hard to read a lot into some of the particulars. And I think that's perfectly natural. And so it's too early to tell. I will say on a couple of key issues, we are reassured. One is on U.S.-China relations. It's very clear that from his own experience studying in the United States, his other associations, he developed a real connection with the Vice President, other high-level engagements. I believe he is in that school that believes and assesses that a good relationship between the United States and China is fundamentally in China's interests. And some of the people around him. And I think that is something to build upon. Beyond that, Jim, I frankly, time will tell, and I think probably there are others that would be better positioned to be able to give you an answer.
Let me just leap on the back of Jim's question and ask you, what did you read and what lessons that the Chinese carried away from the series of stories that the Times carried about Prime Minister Wen and his family dealings? One of the first times that they've had to deal with a media that they couldn't control but was writing about a domestic issue.
I would say, look, you know, there are many sensitive issues in China, as you know, but it in the current environment, issues associated with family members, activities relating to wealth or other instances which may not reflect on the image that the party wants to reflect, those are the issues that strike real concern at senior levels. I think probably that has always been the case, but particularly around leadership transitions, that is key.
Ken?
Kurt, thank you very much. I want to highlight David's introductory comment that what an extraordinarily active, hands-on, effective role you've played over the last 4 years, and especially with regard to China, where our level and scope of discussion is deeper and richer than I think it's ever been. My sense of your comments here is that you think going forward it's kind of steady as she goes. We've laid out lines to Xi Jinping, we've got the Asia-Pacific dialogue, we've got all these different things going, and the Chinese, at least at the highest level, seem to get it. And so you don't hear comments about containment and that kind of thing with regard to the U.S. That goes along, though, with both, as we're all well aware of, more security problems in the region, where we are, you know, kind of declaring our neutrality, but dealing with friends and allies, and the Chinese are on the other side of this. And also, what I hear universally in China, including among very high-level officials, that while there's an enormous desire to work effectively with the United States, there is, if anything, much less faith in U.S. long-term intentions toward China, and much more of an assumption that isn't that we want to contain China, we want to complicate things for them, make it more difficult for them to assume the role in Asia that they think they ought to be able to assume over time. I guess my question is whether you see any significant new initiatives that we ought to be taking as we get a new foreign policy team in place here. You have a whole new team in place in China. Are there things you think we ought to be doing that we haven't been doing to date, or a significant change in the way we're doing anything? Or do you think that basically we've got the game plan right and we're just going through a tough patch at this point, but over time it'll work out for the best?
Thanks, Ken. I didn't mean to convey that I thought that sort of all the machinery was in place and that we sort of had to just sort of continue on. I would actually be, from my perspective, in quite a different camp, which is I think we've made some good progress, but I think we need a much more sustained and continuing dialogue between the United States and China. One of the things that I worry a little bit about is that we have these strategic and economic dialogues. They lead to a period of intense interaction right before the meetings, but perhaps not as much on a continuing basis. And so I'd like to see something that is perhaps a little bit more enduring, and that will be for my and our successors to decide, Ken. You've written a lot about it. I'm convinced that that kind of mechanism would be valuable. How that is structured in you know, just more regular interactions, I think, is critical. Secondly, I believe that the most important thing, and it's turned out to be the hardest, is to find areas, constructive areas, where the United States and China can work together. And those can be big and small issues. We have put forward, and we're working very quietly with China in Timor. We're doing some stuff on development in the Pacific. We're doing some projects together carefully in the lower Mekong. We need to expand cooperative engagement on areas in which we both have an interest in cooperation substantially. Now, I will say, Ken, we have tried very hard, and it's been a challenge, but we have to continue, and we have to articulate the rationale for why clear cooperation on the ground sends a signal not only to each of our countries, but also to the region as a whole. So that would be number two. Number three, I'm a very strong believer in a much deeper and more in-depth people-to-people set of exchanges. And they reflect the positive in our relationship. Ken, you were at the State Department when the Secretary inaugurated the new foundation on 100,000 Strong to increase the number of Americans studying in China. We're excited by that. Those endeavors have to continue. I will tell you that this may strike people as naive, but it is the case that when you come to this part of the agenda in bilateral relations and you start to talk about the people-to-people dimension, it is reassuring to both sides that both sides are committed to some of these engagements. So I think that's going to be important going forward. Fourth, I think that we need two clear dimensions in U.S.-China relations. One is for sustained high-level engagement. And for the Chinese, that's at the White House, that's with the President. And we're going to have to do that in such a way that allows for much deeper and substantial interactions in different settings. Let me give you an example, Kim, and this is just something that hasn't at all yet been considered. We have two kinds of meetings. We meet either in highly formalized, structured interactions in one or the other capitals, in which the stakes are as high as they get, or we meet for an hour and a half in a multilateral setting. And I'm wondering if there's something in between. Have we gotten to that point where we can think about having a longer bilateral meeting, a working meeting, in some informal setting, right? Is that something that
might
be?
What's the model for that? What country
well,
do you do?
I don't like the U.S.-Soviet model because that's not a good model, because that's not what we want with the United States and China. But for years, our leaders met in places like, you know, Helsinki and, Iceland, on ships, Malta, you know, we could do that, and we should think about that. And I think we've reached that stage where a little bit of creativity would be important. So, Ken, that's what we need at the top level. But the other thing that doesn't get as much understanding or publicity, that the great success of the strategic and economic dialogue is in the massive engagement beneath the surface. People, groups that have never worked together, forestry officials that are experts on natural gas, those that have worked together on highway construction, people in both societies who've had remarkably little interaction with one another. And I think that would be very, very valuable going forward. And then lastly, I think a time will come where we need to have almost a dynamic, some sort of setting between the United States and China that has a public-private dimension, that at the same time that you have official engagement, it's backed up by meetings between civil society and business groups and the like. And so what I'm envisioning is pretty much an all-in strategy that is, I think, going to be essential going forward. And then as part of that, frankly, is the corresponding diplomacy around the region for both countries explaining what we're doing and what why we're doing it, and to recognize that when you do that, that raises the stakes for other countries wanting more diplomacy as well. And so what more diplomacy in Asia leads to is the need for more diplomacy, right? And so the demands are enormous, not just in China, but in Asia as a whole. And I think the only way forward between the United States and China can is deeper, substantial, real, constructive, across-the-board engagement between our two societies.
So since we only have a few minutes, we're going to go to the bonus round. So I'm going to ask David and Stanley to put two questions out, and Kurt can pick which one he's going to evade. Okay.
Great. Kurt, as the father of a Marine Corps second lieutenant on Okinawa, I am very grateful for your diplomatic efforts and those of your team in the region. So on that score, could you comment a little bit on the tensions between China and Japan over those islands? Second question, you know I have to ask you. Thank you for the work that you've done and the United States has done to address the Agent Orange legacy in Vietnam. Yeah. What do you anticipate in the second Obama administration in terms of further progress on that point? Thanks. Yeah.
And Stanley?
Let me add my comment. You, the Secretary, and the President really have. Now for the tough question. As you look back on the last 4 years, could you kind of grade where you think we are in regional architecture, which has been one of the priorities of the Obama administration? We've seen the U.S. playing in new things, the East Asia Summit, creating new things, the U.S. ASEAN Summit, playing in things like the ASEAN Defense Ministers Plus and so forth. But we've also seen very difficult ASEAN meetings where things didn't go the way we want, APEC that seems to be struggling for real accomplishment. Where do you think regional architecture is going and should go?
Thanks. Thank you, Stanley. All right. First question, thank you very much. Look, I've pretty much tried to be clear about the tensions between Japan and China. I've said before in the past, we really do want, on these set of circumstances, cooler heads to prevail. We recognize that this issue has stoked nationalist sentiments in both countries, and that at this stage, great care needs to be taken, and both countries have to work together, probably over a sustained period, to de-escalate the situation. And the best way to do that is through an active, engaged diplomacy. And I think we're beginning to see signs of that with the recent determination of some high-level Japanese interlocutors, not just to come once, but perhaps over a sustained period. And I think that's positive, and I think we encourage that overall. We seek to play a stabilizing role. I won't repeat the mantra of what our position is, but we want the action to be on the side of diplomacy right now, not in the waters around the island. On Stanley's question, my particular view is that the most important period ahead is actually in multilateral institutions, particularly in articulating a clear agenda for the East Asia Summit, figuring out how the ASEAN Regional Forum works within the context of the East Asia Summit, and whether and how APEC can support continuing economic engagement in the region as a whole. It's going to take more effort on the part of the United States. I think we've had a good start, Stanley. We're only in the first trimester, so you can't give yourself a grade. It's going to take a very substantial period of time. We are going to need more resources to make this a reality. That means more support for initiatives like the Lower Mekong Initiative in Southeast Asia. It also means that the lesson that we learned from Europe in particular is that multilateral institutions start to get serious when you have secretariats and that there is a sustained, this gets to Ken's point about a more sustaining set of meetings and engagements between officials that don't just take place once a year but take place on a regular basis. That process is beginning in Jakarta. We have an ambassador there. Other countries have sent ambassadors. We need the ASEAN Secretariat to start taking up more responsibility, to take on work products, to try to prepare for summits and the like. I was there in ASEAN this summer, saw the tensions that played out at the ASEAN Regional Forum. I can tell you that most ASEAN countries were deeply concerned by the set of circumstances that led to that. And I think that there are steps that have taken place subsequently that have made clear that countries want to make sure that some of the dynamics that appeared there will not be repeated going forward. But we should be under no illusions that, you know, there will be tension in these meetings. There are a lot of hard issues that have to be discussed, and I think the approach of an active American engagement is critical here. I will also say this is one of those areas where Europe really has an important role to play. They have learned a lot about institution building in difficult circumstances, and they can apply some of those lessons, I think, quite effectively in Asia. On Agent Orange, lastly, I forgot that. I will say I have found ever since the Aspen Institute has implemented this incredibly innovative program, I have more and more senators and congressmen asking me about it and how to support it going forward. I think it has been a small down payment on goodwill in Vietnam. In whatever endeavor, I want to make sure that that process goes forward personally going.
We'll do just two very last ones, Patrick and Hyde.
Thank you, Kurt. You just touch on a little bit on that one. Can you a little bit further comment on our relationships in the South China Sea, especially related to Vietnam and to the Philippines, mm-hmm. and also just a little update on what is the status in the Cocos Island?
Thank you. My question regarding the new type of relationship between China and U.S. I just want to know how far the discussion is going on this issue and how U.S. has responded to this new type of relationship.
Thanks. When you say new type of relationship, you're talking about the
new type of relationship between China and U.S. that China has been raising.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, yeah. Look, I think the general tenets of that, more consultation, deeper dialogue we share and want to implement. And I think there is a desire in the Obama administration to find those areas that we can work together and then deal constructively on areas that where we disagree. I think everyone understands and has looked carefully at the sometimes tragic history of hegemonic transitions, and we recognize some of the situations that must be avoided at all costs. One of the most, as you look at history, one of the most worrisome features of certain dynamics that have played out in the past is a sense in the rising country that they are denied a place, a rightful place on the international stage. That was certainly the case with Germany both before the First and the Second World Wars. I think it would be clear to say that one of the most important features of American diplomacy across several generations is actually to make clear that China has an incredibly important role to play in international architecture, pushing hard for the creation of the G20, which will increasingly play a dynamic role going forward. If anything, I think sometimes it's the United States pushing and wanting China to play an active role, and sometimes China being sometimes ambivalent about those conditions, whether it's on issues like climate change or what have you. But I think we have an active discussion with China about how to avoid those circumstances that can lead to undue friction. And one of those areas, Patrick, I'm not going to run through the mantra, which you've heard many times before, what our policy is, but it is absolutely clear that a dialogue has to take place between the United States and China, not just on military issues, but in particular on maritime issues. As China, military activities extend further offshore, invariably there will be more interaction with American forces. And it will be important for the United States and China to understand more about what the rules of the road are in terms of how we interact, but as importantly, how to deal with a potential miscalculation or incident. And I have to say, if I could, just to conclude on the issue that concerns us, one of many, but on the Senkaku Diutai set of circumstances, is you've got the potential for accidents and inadvertence that could be deeply damaging and cause a set of circumstances that frankly would have enormous ramifications for the region as a whole. So I look, I think it's very positive that there is a rich academic discussion in China about how to support U.S.-China relations. I agree with Ken and others around the table, Jim, who underscore that there is anxiety about how difficult that process will be. I do think that there is a very important role that both the academy and think tank community can play. I have found over the course of the last few years that some of the best ideas, some of the most interesting, innovative approaches have come to us through those venues. And in times where it's too difficult to test propositions and ideas in a track one format, sometimes we try them out first on the track two format, and then if they're ready, take them to track 1.5. And so I think that venue, and I should have added it to the long list I gave Ken, that issue on issues like trilateral engagement between the United States, Japan, and China, issues related to maritime issues, how to be more effective on cyber-related concerns. These are areas where Track 2 and other sort of non-official venues allow both sides more flexibility and openness to discuss very difficult issues.
Well, thank you very much, Kurt. You've given us a real tour of the territory. It's been terrific. I know that, John, I hope that whenever you're done with this job, you'll have time to go back to more fun things. And Jonathan, I know you had a few things you wanted to conclude.
I just wanted to thank everyone for coming and give a special thanks to Michelle Smith and the Robert H. Smith Foundation that made this event possible. It's part of the Washington Ideas Roundtable series. Thank you all for coming and hope you'll join us next time. Special thanks to Assistant Secretary Kurt Campbell and, of course, David Sanger for joining us today. Thank you all.